Because
somehow that you passed through that COVID suffering and came out finally. Then where did you get the strength from to give 500 ml of plasma? In my case, if I was asked to give 1 ml of blood, no, after coming out from such a big illness, I'd be like definitely saying no.
No, you should not be saying that, Karan, because right now I don't think I was any special, because a lot of people have been donating plasma. So I was not at all special. The only thing could be is that I was the first patient, but I actually did not know that I was the first person to donate plasma. And 500 ml is not big deal. The 500 ml will be regenerated within 2 days. Okay, every ml won't pain you. Even if they take 1000 ml, it will be the same pain of putting a needle inside your hand. Okay, there is no difference between taking 500 ml, and of course they'll take 500 ml. If they say I'll give you only 50 ml, they'll say you keep it with yourself. Okay, so it is all about the awareness. Actually, when I went to donate, I truly did not know that I was the first person to donate. I thought, okay, I was the 16th person to recover in the state, so the 15 people would have donated. So it's my turn, 16th person. I only got to know that I was the first person next day when all the news channels, all the TV reporters, everybody queued up outside my house early in the morning. Then I got to know, oh, this is the reason. I was the first person, apparently. So the idea of starting COVID-19 task force also started there only, because that is the point where I realized that a lot of people are not donating plasma. Then I thought more awareness needs to be pumped into people. We need to create a proper channel where somebody is actually motivating the recovered people. So our task was much more tougher last year, because we had to actually explain people what plasma is. We had to tell them it's not liver. Okay, we had to tell them it's not kidney. We had to tell them, bro, it is plasma easier to donate than blood. Because at least in blood, once you donate, you can't donate for another 6 months. But what happens with plasma, you can donate within 1 month. Again, you can actually donate within 15 days. If your every level, all the levels are good, you can redonate in 15 days. I did donate. I donated second time. I was also the first person to redonate plasma, to explain people that you can redonate. Okay. I had to redonate because to create awareness in people that not just once, you can keep donating. Okay, so the awareness was important at that point of time. Because just imagine, think, look at this word, plasma. Like, plasma sounds like alien. Okay, we do not know what plasma is. They thought it was an organ. Honestly, people thought, sir, if I give off my plasma, what about plasma for me? Okay, so whose responsibility was it? It was the responsibility of the government to tell them, but we did appeal a lot to the chief minister, to the health minister. I don't know what their priorities were at that point of time. None of them responded with plasma, but only governor actually responded. She did respond. She called me to Raj Bhavan at that point of time, because I think she responded maybe because she was a doctor by herself. Okay, she understood what is the importance of plasma. Then she spoke with the chief secretary. And that is how the ESI Plasma Bank started. The actual plasma bank, the state-run plasma bank, is started after such deliberations.
Like here in Telangana, we see that many people hesitate and are reluctant to take that initiative to create something, to create a task force and support people. So what was that thing? And you were we feel we should have a godfather to support us to do all these things, right? So what was that? Where do you get so much courage, and what made you really do this, build this
Let me
amazing
tell you.
thing?
Okay, I understood. I understood. Courage. These are all very huge words to use. There is no courage required. I don't have any courage to start C9 task force. Okay, it's simply one group where people like you. For example, tomorrow I'm telling you, you guys can create a pro help group for your own community, like OU College of Chemical Technology. You yourself are starting a group where you try to pool in resources from your side. It's just a collective effort. Okay, it doesn't take a big deal. All of you know how to use WhatsApp, right? Okay, right now you got a lot of information about how Plasma works, who is eligible for Plasma. I told you the places where you can gather information from. Go to ICMR's website. There's no use with WHO's website because generalized information. Okay, so you know where reliable sources are. You yourself can start one. It's no big deal. It literally took me maybe 1 hour to set it up.
I mean, Anna, like it is a public thing, right? So many things come into the picture. So many there'll be many forces trying to stop you or create some obstacles. So how do you manage all those?
Well, I think I've been involved with public life for very long right now, so I actually have no problem in handling them. I'm a lawyer by profession. I work on human rights. So I do get a lot of, I get better threats than what I work with Plasma. Okay, I get better threats from people asking me to not fight a certain case than asking me to not work on certain Plasma requests. So I think, and again, there is no such thing that nobody is going to call and threaten you telling why are you working with Plasma, okay, this and that. But the only thing is you need to be more responsible, okay, because you're working in public profile. Your work involves influencing a lot of people. You're influencing thought. You're influencing energy. Okay. So you're influencing people, whoever is around you. You are responsible. You're answerable. You're accountable. All of these things you just need to keep into your picture, and then I think you're good to go with. You just need to have good sources. You need to have good people who can guide you. Okay. And I think everybody is good to go with their own initiative. Right now, just leave about Plasma. You have n number of organizations that are trying to help with food deliveries. Okay. People are going and giving food to people around their communities. Okay. They're just connecting. They're collecting funds from places. They're just giving people... For example, there's in LB Nagar, there's an organization called Rice ATM. Okay. In that Rice ATM, if you really don't have any kind of pulses, rice, vegetables, you can actually go there and ask and they'll give it to you for free of cost. So ideas, there is no lack of ideas in us. We just need to channelize them. You have an idea, put a thought into it for an hour. Don't leave it. I'm sure all of you get ideas. Put a thought into it for 1 hour. Okay, write it down. Take a notebook, make a triangular chart. Okay, make a Venn diagram, whichever you're convenient with. Write it. How can you implement this idea? And what are the good points of the idea? What are the good effects and negative effects? Positive and negative. Okay, and see who can help you with this idea. Okay, identify the proper resources. Okay, then see what all resources you need. Okay, right now sir spoke about website would have been much more expenditure for me to maybe set it up. Okay, and also I actually, even to date, I do not feel the need of a website for my own time. Okay, because maybe website I have to take it to give more wider reach into people, but honestly I do not have that much of volunteer database. Also, volunteer needs a leader. Simply 100 volunteers can't keep working. You need a leader who will handle all the volunteers. Okay, so everything needs to be channelized in that way. Right now, I simply can't, for the capacity that I have, I'm only able to handle 20 volunteers. I can't add up unless I get a similar supervisor who can handle equally like me. If I can't do justice to more people, I better do not create a bigger force.
Thank you, Anna.
Hello, Anna. First of all, thank you for accepting our invitation and connecting with us, joining with us. The way you are explaining is like really good. Nowadays, I don't know it's correct or wrong, but nowadays I've seen less people like you as a lawyer fighting for the people. I don't know if it's correct or not, but I saw very few people like you. You are fighting for the people. That's like really good. And one thing we'll be thinking about in ESL, like, is that we should not complain about things. We need to take initiative. I think you took that initiative. Even we, in some cases, we are thinking of taking initiative. rather than complaining on like how the society is going on and the other things. So I'm like very glad to meet you, that person like you who are taking initiatives and all. My question is like, you are focusing on de-stressing calls, right? From people. So the volunteers, like who all the volunteers are taking this de-stressing calls are also getting stressed, right? Listening to that heartbreaking story.
Yeah, like very good question. So this is distress management.
What is the thing which you are following to de-stress?
Yeah, so you're asking me what I follow.
For
example, I do sometimes break down myself, because it gets actually very overwhelming to attend a lot of distress calls. Okay, so distress management is again a technique. So I do not do it by myself. I do not handle a lot of distress calls. Okay, because my role is different. What happens is we have trained volunteers. Volunteers simply doesn't mean the people who are volunteers are professionals. The volunteers that we have are counselors, professional counselors. Okay, their education has been in counseling. They were trained to counsel. They were trained to listen sad stories. They were trained to listen to you crying. Okay, like how I was trained to take a murder case very easily, like how I am trained to listen to something very horrific very easily, like how you could be trained to handling so much of technological things, like how a doctor is trained to perform surgeries and look at blood without getting fainted. They are trained to listen to sad stories. Okay, so but I do not say that counselors also need counseling. Okay, counselors also need to sit for a day, have some fun, go on a holiday. But right now, all of that is far-fetched. When frontline warriors like doctors are working more than 20 hours a day sometimes, with 2 to 3 hours of sleep. Okay, I have friends myself who are working in COVID wards as doctors, who are working for long, long, long durations. Okay, when they themselves can't take breaks, I think I'm at a comfort of home. Okay, I'm sitting at home attending calls. I don't think I'm doing anything much bigger than what they are doing. So it's okay for me to go for a long stretch without getting a good holiday for distressing myself.
Yeah, one of our friends are telling real Vakil Saab. Yes, you are. Thank you, Anna.
Anna, firstly, I would like to mention one point. When I came to know about your live, and I have gone through your live in Instagram and also in few channels. Actually, that I'm one of the few who feared a lot during the initial days. But your video inspired me a lot. Thank you for it, Anna. And also, I have one question. Like, there are 40 plus countries who have given oxygen cylinders to the government. But is government really helping us? Should we believe in the government? And there are also many influencers. They are giving plasma donations, those all. What we should believe in?
Okay, let this still be an apolitical platform, but I think criticizing the government or praising a government is not a political move, okay? I'm not going to talk on party lines. As we all citizens of this country, we have right to critically analyze what our government has been doing, right? Okay, so regardless of our party lines, political ideologies, political inclinations, we do have we have right to our opinion on what the government has been doing. Our government has been absolutely mismanaged. Because if it is not your duty, whose else's duty is it to predict that a second wave is going to happen? You are such a huge government with policy makers. You have government with everything. You are foreseeing everything. When you can foresee that a cyclone can happen in next a few months, okay, something disastrous, earth is going to melt, like glaciers are going to melt, you can predict so many things. Was it so difficult for you to use, apply some common sense and predict it? So it's not about the central government, it's not about the state government. Governments as a whole have failed in catering to the health needs of the country. But I personally believe more than the coronavirus crisis that we are facing, it is the capitalism crisis that we are facing today. I don't know how many people know the difference right now between capitalism and socialism, but right now the crisis that we all are facing is crisis of capitalism. Just think, is a person who is unable to afford 10 lakhs on the treatment, can he even go for a COVID bed? No, they're not even letting you get admitted. The reason is health is 90% of the health in our country is in private sector. Okay, so the country, the welfare state, you know, in political science, this is a concept. The concept of welfare state is when health and education are completely in the hands of government. Health and education should have no private participation, minimal private participation, negligible private participation. Okay, only then everybody, because health and education are very basic. It doesn't depend upon what is your financial capacity. It doesn't depend upon who your parents are. So health and education are two things which only governments have to handle. If you look at welfare states like the Scandinavian countries are those nearby the North Pole, like Denmark, Finland, Sweden, okay, Norway. These are the countries. These are called Scandinavian countries. In these countries, health and education are absolutely in the hands of government. Okay, it could be any big operation. It could be any big surgery. You don't have to spend a penny. There is no hospital which takes money from you. Okay, and at the same time, not even that. If, for example, I have lived in UK. Even in UK, there is nothing called health insurance. You don't have to take a health insurance. There is something called NHS, National Health Service. Anybody and everybody who got any kind of illness, you simply walk into a hospital, you get treated. And you just walk out. Nobody goes to a private school there. Like, for example, going to a private school is a huge deal. In UK, when my university, in the initial days, during a debate, somebody asked, how many of you went to a private school? All Indians lifted hands. Okay, all the Indians lifted hands. Like, for example, you lift the hand. How many of you went to private schools? Okay. But there, nobody goes to a private school. Going to private school is a big deal. You don't have to go to a private school because their government schools are more competent than our private schools. Our private schools are nothing. Like, our private schools are absolute pile of garbage, I'll have to tell you, the education system. Okay, I don't take any backstep in criticizing our education system. We are a pile of garbage when we look at our education. Okay, that is what we induce into our minds. Like, we are at a stage where we tell that co-education is not good. We need a separate classroom for girls and boys. Okay, which is going to create more problems in the future. Okay, today, that kind of education system we are coming from. Okay, so we have a lot to look upon. We have a lot to learn from COVID. COVID has not created a health crisis. COVID has created a crisis of life. COVID has created a crisis of livelihood. Okay, it asks us to review what kinds of governments are we electing. It asks us to review what kinds of governments are we prioritizing. What our governments are prioritizing. A government that prioritizes a religious congregation like Kumbh Mela, okay, when a whole second wave of pandemic is happening, a government which actively conducts political rallies, regardless of party lines, it could be any party, when a second wave of pandemic is happening, why do you think only India is suffering so badly with this surge in pandemic? Because we have been absolutely reckless. And I do not blame people. I do not at all blame people. I don't think anybody is going on the roads just simply to have fun. How many of you think that people, you know, when we are going on the road, we ourselves think, see, so many people are on the roads. Why are these people on the roads? Absolutely for no reason. But why are you on the road? I don't call you, you're on the road for no reason. You are going on some work. Everybody is going on some work. So when all of this is happening, that is how the system works. If places are open, we go on work. Instead, the government should have planned in such a way that an absolute lockdown was not necessary in the first wave. Okay, we could have let certain system work, like offices, for example, restaurants, these could have functioned while the lockdown was still being in process, so that the construction sector, the infrastructure sector should have let function, because people don't gather while you're building a building. People don't gather. Yep, workers are working, but they will get COVID. Yeah, that is what planning is. Let them get COVID, because they're bound to get COVID even in the next wave. In that way, our economy would not have been shattered. Today, we would have been able to afford a lockdown. If our lockdown was not that strict last year, which was absolutely not necessary, there were no cases and we were simply sitting at home having a lockdown. Okay, so you should have let more time. April was not at all the time for lockdown. You should have let May happen. In May, let the cases reach a while, then impose a lockdown for a time, then release it. Then let more cases come, then impose a lockdown, release it. Now, also you should have been able to do that. But today, because of the economic suffering that we had last year, today, right now in the second wave, we cannot afford a lockdown economically. This is a failure of the planning of the government, because the priorities of the government have been different. I'm sorry if I'm running out of time. Like, am I? Like, I think it's been an hour since we started speaking.
Okay, Anna, if it is fine with you.
No, I have no problem.
We are not at all having problems.
Anna, thank you for accepting our invitation and thank you for attending.
Do you have any more questions? I'm free to answer.
Yes, Anna. So my question is, being youth, how can we avoid the black market thing? It's everywhere in India.
Black so market regarding what?
They are selling medicines to a higher rate in black market. They're selling oxygen cylinders at a higher rate. Like the injection also, which they need. Yeah. So how can we avoid that?
What's your name?
Vivekta.
Yeah. Hi. So. Yeah, the question which you asked is very relevant, but unfortunately, the black market functions on supply and demand. Okay, when there is demand and when there is no supply, black market automatically starts. It's simply like onions or potatoes. You find 10 rupees a kilo onion and 2 months later, 100 rupees a kilo. How does it happen? This is called hoarding. Okay, we hoard. It is not because we don't have stock. We hoard them. I get calls on the helpline asking, sir, I suspect that I have COVID. Can I get remdesivir injection? Okay. Like, how gone are you in your head? But I really pity them, because that is the kind of situation we have created. The government, which is supposed to handle all of this, which is supposed to regulate, which is supposed to do the job that we guys are doing today, is simply not doing anything. So at that moment, when people are filled with misconceptions, they're hoarding it. And private holding, I mean, people personally hoarding is not so much, but companies are hoarding it. We need regulation. We need drug control regulations, which are not in place. Our drug control regulations are so lax. We have fake remdesivir coming up. Forget about black market. We have fake remdesivir coming up. People buying a single vial of remdesivir injection for 30,000 rupees, where it is nothing but distilled water inside. The vial has only distilled water inside. You're buying distilled water. You're buying literally 10 ml of distilled water for 1,20,000 rupees. Okay. I have seen, you know, there's an injection called tocilizumab. Okay. It is an anti-inflammatory injection. Okay. that injection, I have seen them buy it for 7 lakh rupees, a single vial. Okay, MRP is 30,000, of course, but I have seen people buy it for 7 lakh rupees. So that is the condition of black market in our country right now.
It actually looks like Hasita had a question before me. So Hasita, do you want to ask?
Yes, Aisha. Hello, brother. This is Hasita. It's just a basic question. I want a little suggestion from you. As I see there are many teenagers in our meeting right now. What do you suggest for us for tackling with our mental health? For an example, right now, I am in such a situation where some of my family members tested positive, so I have to get quarantined as I'm the first person in contact with them. And I have to take care of them as well as my studies, balancing both, which is obviously a stress for me. What do you suggest for us so that we can tackle this situation right now?
Firstly, I'm very sorry that all of your family has tested positive, Hasita. But the thing with your mental health is, I just want to tell you that people in your age group, for example, there's a very less mortality rate and there is very less fatality rate. Let me be specific. In that age group. Okay. So firstly, I want you to take situation lightly. And I want you to monitor your family situation in a very systematic manner. Stop going by what that person, this person without reliable sources would say. To any person, this answer is for everyone. To any person that is testing positive, the first thing that I would want to tell is, firstly, you get your RT-PCR or whatever, for example, positive, rapid antigen, or you, for example, your high resolution CT scan, you're tested positive. One person in the family tested positive, the other people get their strain or their test negative, doesn't matter, they're positive. Okay. Then you just need to keep monitoring certain things, your pulse, your fever, and your saturations, oxygen saturations. So for that, you need to have a pulse oximeter at home, a pulse oximeter which is reliable. I only recommend two brands which I have personally seen reliable. That is, one is BPL, which is a very authentic and which is very reliable manufacturer of medical equipment for decades. The second one is an American brand called Dr. Trust. Okay. I have seen fake oximeters. Again, oximeter is a huge scam in our country right now. I have seen oximeter where I put a pencil inside and it is still showing 99. Okay. So basically, whatever you put inside, it will show you a reading. It doesn't need a finger. So I want you to use an oximeter which is reliable. When your readings are within limit, within the prescribed scale, there's absolutely that you don't have to worry about. You keep going, and the virus, as how it entered, it exits out. But when things are going out of control, then you need to seek expert medical help. If you have your family doctor or if you have medical resources around you, you're fine, you're good to go. But if you do not have, again, you have our helpline where you can actually put in your request and a qualified medical professional will call you back. Okay, and they will tell you what are the medications that you have to use. What are the tests? There are certain parameters which we need to check with your blood. So when you think everything is fine and in control, I don't think there's anything that you have to worry about. Your mental health can be handled by yourself when you know that all is well. So you just need to know that everything is well.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Go ahead, Apurva. You had a question. I'll wait.
I just had a doubt that you have said that the government should have imposed the lockdown little later, but people don't have awareness about this coronavirus and all this thing happening at that moment, right? So if they have not imposed a lockdown, then little more cases have come out and people used to be even more panic and the psychological situation might get disturbed, right? So how could that be?
Yeah, so that is what I'm trying to tell you. That is what is called planning. Okay, when you know that it's a pandemic raging and when you know that it is going to spread regardless, you should have been planned for years, not for a month. You should not plan for, we have a 5-year plan. Okay, we vote a government not for a month, we vote a government for 5 years. So the government is ought to know what they're supposed to do in the 4th year of their governance. So they have to plan from right now. So when you know that second wave is going to happen, when you know that it is going to spread anyway, when you know that India is a huge unorganized sector of economy, you know what unorganized sector of economy means? Example, we pay salaries to a lot of people based on cash we pay without their accounts are not monitored. We simply pay out cash. You don't know how many employees you have. Okay, there are a lot of daily laborers, daily wage laborers who do not even have provident fund. So when you're handling so much of unorganized sector, you are supposed to have planning. That is why a government is there. And our government is not weak. We have government full of resources. We have government full of policy makers. Policy makers are not politicians. Policy makers are people who are civil servants. Okay, they are supposed to do that job. The job of the civil servant, the secretaries and the advisors in the government, their job is to advise the government when to impose lockdown, when not to impose lockdown. So the other countries have not imposed such a strict lockdown like India. There, for example, in UK also there was lockdown, but the train services were never completely shut. The home deliveries of food was not completely shut. So if the home deliveries of food was not shut, chefs wouldn't have lost their job. People wouldn't have suffered. Like people, for example, people living like bachelors in a lot of places where they're working or studying, they would not have suffered for food. If the construction sector was going on, migrant laborers would not have had to travel a lot of kilometers by foot. That is what you call planning. So when that was happening, right now, economy would not have shattered so much. Right now, you would have been able to, because you should have known that pandemic is going to spread regardless of whatever you do. Right now, we would have had an opportunity to impose a similar lockdown like last year, where you have controlled use of your the facilities that you have available, controlled use of buses, controlled use of trains, no dine-in, only takeaway or only deliveries of restaurants, only construction sector can work. Okay, only offices with so-and-so number of people can work, social distancing measures. This all right now we are unable to do, because if we do it, instead of COVID, we will die of hunger, livelihood issues. So that is what I mean planning. We should have imposed lockdown a lot later. That is what all the international studies have proved also.
So Akhil, thank you very much for answering so many questions. And thank you also for doing, you know, from a ground level, trying to support the many people and also trying to be a leader and encouraging many, many, these young people also to participate. I have been, obviously I'm quite older than you I have thought through many things. I have been in US. I have participated in many activities. I have been working with the people since 1991. And I have not stopped. So what I've noticed is we are very, very concerned only about us. We don't work as a group. We don't sit together and talk and say, let us, you know, see what is going on here. Simple things like apartment complex where my parents live. They had huge water issues. So I said, let us plan so that way there is no water issues next year. And so I proposed an idea. Do you know how many people came? Zero. Do you know how many people even wanted to talk? Zero. again, you know what is going to happen? Water problem will happen again next year. And do you know what they'll say? We need money to fix this problem. With all the brains that there are there, all smart people in this apartment complex, it's like, I think it's very expensive apartment complex. And there are so many people who have brains and everything. And not one person is willing to come and sit and plan long term. So our system, our education system, in my opinion, like you said, it's garbage. It has been garbage for the last 50, 60, 70 years. I don't know when it has been garbage like that. So I have figured out long, you know, a while ago that I have to put, you know, there is an ocean of garbage out there, and I'm using a spoon to remove this ocean of garbage. And I'm just going to keep on removing, use that spoon to remove one spoon at a time. And yes, you know, yes, that garbage is still going to be there even after I die. But that's what I feel right now. It is so huge. All of us together have to keep on saying, let us work together, let us think together, let us talk together. It has to be happening in homes, it has to be happening in groups, you know, in neighborhoods, it has to happen in colleges, it has to happen everywhere. You know, like you just said, why can't we just have a small group? Why can't you just, you know, start a small group about COVID? You have, WhatsApp. So when I started this work with the students and other things in India, people said, hey, you're not local. You can't do anything. I said, you know what? At least I'll try. If I cannot, I cannot. But at least I'll try. There is a new change has happened, which is social media has opened up. There is internet. So maybe I can do something. So it has worked. So I think I want all of you to think is really, really question what is education, which is really, really important, need to really think, and then work together. Talk with among each other. And complaining, criticizing is very easy. And that's one thing we really, really we do very, very less in our group. So I thank you very much. I have to leave. That's why I am saying my final words here. Thank you, Akhil, for coming onto the call. And, you know, please keep in touch with us. And we are hopefully someone will give you our website. You will see that we have done some incredible work. And I think we will keep on doing incredible work far into the future. So please do keep in touch with us, and we will definitely keep in touch with you. Thank you.
Definitely, sir. I would love to learn more about your work, and I'd love to collaborate with you if possible. And we can definitely stay in touch hereafter, not just on formal talks like this. Maybe we can collaborate privately as well if any of you have any initiatives. Could be in any way, not just COVID, because COVID might end, but our work will have to continue further.
Thank you so much, sir. It is very happy that we have interacted with a powerful leader, a great lawyer, and a social activist, or I don't know how to put in simple words. And now I'm going to present you a gratitude card. So we're going to present you a gratitude card for accepting our invitation. Just a sec. So thank you, Akhil NMCT sir. We express our heartfelt gratitude for accepting our invitation and sparing your valuable time. Thank you for supporting us. Thank you for making us aware of the current situation. So, gratitude team.
Thank you all of you. At such a young age, you all have been very enthusiastic to know about this pandemic. And I really believe that all of you will one day reach all the goals that you are aspiring for today. Okay, your college is a wonderful college that I've had friends from your senior batches long time ago. Okay, so I would look forward to work with you guys sometime in the future. Let's see if we can collaborate in more further ways. Please reach out to me if you have anything that I can help you with. Okay, do stay in touch. Thank you so much.